So first of all, I'm Vijay Avanis. It's Vijay for short, and I make music under the name Pursue Grooves. And I started when I was about 15 years old, and I was also an MC and vocalist, but mostly an MC. And I started MCing over vinyl instrumentals. But then I realized that I kind of wanted to work. I kind of wanted to see if I could make my own beats. I attended a performing arts school. I was a theater major, but at my school, you also took the other disciplines. So you also took visual art, you took film, you took music. And the whole time, I spent a lot of time with my grandmother. She had a piano. And so I asked my mother for my own keyboard. This keyboard had like five tracks on there, which allowed me to layer sounds, which changes the game, honestly. Even though I was limited to the sounds that were in the keyboard, versus sampling other sounds outside of what was given to me, that's what I started with. And from there, slowly but surely, started picking up drum machines and samplers and synthesizers. And, like I said, when I started, I was 15, and this is in the mid 90s, not to date myself, but in the mid 90s. And I didn't know many other people my age who were into making beats. And I learned a lot through magazines. Looked at a lot of magazines, and it's funny because I remember when I started really paying attention to what a producer was. Anyone familiar with New Jack Swing? Yes, no, yes, no.
Yeah, I've heard
Yeah,
of it.
right. New Jack Swing, it's a genre of music that was like pretty much coined by Teddy Riley. Teddy Riley is like one of the dopest producers, whether it was with Guy, whether it was with his group Blackstreet. He did stuff for Michael Jackson. And who studied under him? Chad and Pharrell. The Neptunes came up under his studio in Virginia when they were really young, and when they were in high school. Also from Virginia, who came up under him was Timbaland. Okay. But Timbaland also ended up studying under Devontae Swing of the group Jodeci. Anyone familiar with Jodeci? R&B group. So that, and I'll say Jimmy Jam and Terry Lewis, who did stuff for Janet Jackson and so forth, really got me into paying attention to a producer and or like the sound that each one of them had, an identifiable sound. And I thought, that's pretty cool. That's kind of what I want to do. I enjoy performing, but for me, being able to make the music, one, allowed me to be self-contained, but also allowed me to maybe make music for other people, also try different genres, and just to be overall have more creative control than just rhyming over 12-inch piece of vinyl. That basically, when MySpace came out, I started sharing beats on there. Luckily met a great international community of beat makers, which was next level. There was nothing like that before where you could meet. I'm from Maryland originally. That's the Washington, D.C. metro area. And on MySpace, I met beat makers from New York, from Paris, from London, from Australia, like international, which was amazing. And we were able to share beats, and also a lot of label owners were on there. So it was a lot more accessible to share what you were working on and so forth. And from there, has anyone heard of Red Bull Music Academy? RBMA? So the drink Red Bull, so they sponsor a lot of different cultural events. And for 20 years, they've ran this event called Red Bull Music Academy, RBMA, which basically they would host 60 participants from around the world to a 2-week program of lectures, studio time, and within that, they would also encourage collaboration. So this is an all expense paid camp. And they would select you, bring you to wherever it is that year. The year I got in was in Barcelona. And you would literally, they'd put you up in this warehouse, or the students would be set up in the warehouse. They'd give you all the gear you could ever dream of, any and everything you wanted. And you would just create. And then they would just encourage you to work together so that by the end of the session, you'd have a CD, and usually a double CD. Now, the lecturers during the day could be anyone, and you wouldn't know until you got there. So let's say my year, Chuck D was a speaker. Sly and Robbie were speakers. These are this that they are the heart of reggae music. Anyone that you can think of who was a producer or even a gear maker like Tom Oberheim or any of the machines that you can think of or engineers, D'Angelo's engineer, Renee Elizondo was there helping us mix our tracks. It was amazing. And I tell you, we all cried when it was over. Because I think we realized how lucky we were to be in that space and how inspiring it was. And it was a really big opportunity for me because pretty much from there, I had the opportunity to tour all over Europe, performing instrumental beat music, instrumental hip hop. I'm coming from the time of Flying Lotus and Teebs and Machine Drum and No Such Thing. These are a lot of my peers at the time, and a lot of us would cross paths doing the beat circuit because there really was a beat circuit internationally of different promoters putting on events. It's interesting. Whether you're a producer, you're making music for other people, or you're a producer and you see yourself as an artist and you are the focus, anything is possible. If you think of Pharrell, he produces for other people, but he also is an artist in his own right, which is super, super, super dope. So yeah, that's a big part of my journey. I've put out a number of releases, and I've been really lucky to do remixes for some cool people. And since I've stuck with it for so long, I was really lucky to have the opportunity last year, last winter, to consult and instruct for a Disney film that was filming here in Toronto about young DJs and young beat makers. It's insane. It's really crazy insane. My job was to instruct on basic turntable skills and mixing and also basic beat production. And it comes out in fall of 2021. If all goes well, everything should be fine. I know we finished editing in January. So if all goes well, it will be, yeah, kind of, yeah. Just look out for it. We filmed all over Toronto. We filmed at Sonic Boom, which was crazy because we had to change everything inside the store. Anything that said Sonic Boom got changed to a different name. We changed all the t-shirts. We had fake vinyl covers. We had everything. And this is the first time I'd ever worked on a film. So it was a lot to learn, but they basically just wanted me to share my expertise, and I couldn't have asked for a better situation, and a better opportunity. So, being an artist, it's not easy. And I always stress that you have to approach it from a position of love and expression and not money. Because once it becomes a money thing, you start to lose that freshness, and that creativity when you approach the music. And I think nowadays there are a lot more people, because it's the entry level is a lot more accessible in terms of how affordable the gear is. The software back in the day was not cheap. Where now you can get a cracked piece of software for free, and you can do almost anything. I mean, you can make beats on your iPad. Is anyone familiar with Madlib? Yeah. So, Madlib's up here making Freddie Gibbs stuff, beats on his iPad. You know what I mean? You can take your iPad anywhere. So he's up here making albums anywhere. Madlib's one of those people who have always approached it from a no-frills perspective, and very simple, whatever his sampler of choice is at the moment. And he just works hard all day, all the time, and doesn't focus too much on the business or the legal aspects of sampling, which we can touch on a bit as well. Always good to have somebody looking into that and taking care of that, because that can get you into some trouble. So yeah, that film comes out later, and I think the thing I'm most excited about is that, one, the lead character is a female, which is amazing, which is also part of the reason why they hollered at me, and female director, which is another dope thing. And I really like the fact that they explored a few different approaches to making music. And yeah, that really excited me when I read the script, and that it just wasn't just 100% laptop driven. Because I think you can DJ on your laptop, that's great, but the fact that we spend so much time talking about vinyl and how important that relationship is to music and DJing, and that tactile element, and that's a big part of the story. I thought it was a really, really awesome perspective for younger folks getting into the scene right now. So yeah, I'm excited, and like I said, that only came from me being active and being visible and having stuck with it for this long. It's not something I applied to. So, like I say, it's things come if you stick with it. But I think if your sole purpose is to make money from the art form, it gets a bit tricky. Yeah, and what I mentioned to Marco earlier is that, we'll get into this a little bit later, but when we're talking about like quality of music, or what's good and what's bad, I don't see things from that perspective, because there are so many different genres of music, and even within those genres, I don't like to think of it as genres, because even that is limiting. I think it's best to just play and experiment, and that's probably the thing that's going to make you stand out the most anyway. I don't really understand when people want to copy or imitate. I understand when you're first learning that that's what happens, but people who stand out to me have a much longer life in this industry, than folks who are always copying and try to make what they've already heard. That's usually because of money, but I personally see music as a source of expression, and that's what's the most important for me, and that's the thing that's going to keep me from not draining out. And I never want to get to the point where I don't want to make music anymore. I love it too much. So yeah, that's basically me. I'm just going to show a few pictures of me and my samplers. Sometimes I sample, sometimes I don't. Samplers were hardware samplers. If you know Pete Rock, if you know Primo, if you know Dilla, if you know any of those guys, like whether they had studied music or not, most of them didn't. Some of them did. It basically leveled the playing field. The sampler gave you the ability to sample anything, any sound, anything, and make a composition. So that's why I think being able to sample just opens the playing field in so many different ways and allows you to experiment. Now, what you do after that's on you. I have albums where I don't use any samples at all. I love synthesizers. But yeah, there are reasons for that in terms of licensing and stuff. So I'm just going to show a couple pics, and then I'm going to share some more info about Loop Sessions Toronto. Cool. Has anyone heard of Loop Sessions Toronto? Have you heard of it at all? Okay, I'm a show some info. So I'm just going to share my screen. Let's see. All right, these are some shameless plugs here, but just so that you just kind of see a bit about me. Over here on the right, here's me with two SP505s. If anyone's familiar with the SP404, like that's also a very popular sampler, and it's also very affordable. It's a very affordable entry point into the sampling world. I have a larger version of that. I've got my first one in like 2001, 2002, and I just love it. I have three of them. I use them to tour. But now I'm actually on an MPC Live, which is a major step up from the SP505. But I also don't think, it's necessary to have the best and the biggest, whether it's gear or software. I think you can take the simplest thing, and as long as your audio source is open and wide, you can do anything. Okay, there's a plethora of things you can do. So yeah, yada yada. There's some different live performance pics and so forth, and like I said, like growing up in Maryland, I don't think I thought that I would have traveled to Australia, Japan, Lithuania, UK, Spain, Greece, France, Netherlands, like all over. And this is all because of music. So I'm by no way, shape, or means, a huge name, but I've had the amazing opportunity of touring just from beat music and getting to see the world and sharing, which has been a beautiful thing. So I'm now going to show a bit of loop sessions. So Loop Sessions Toronto is a part of a large umbrella of Loop Sessions. There are chapters all over the world. I honestly cannot keep count right now. But we started in January of 2019. We just had our anniversary last month. And the first year we met in person. Let me see, I have some shots here. This is one of our pics here, which was really fun. Kind of sad that we don't do this in person anymore, but such is life. So we were meeting up in a variety of venues across the city, which is really cool too, from Collective, which is like a spray paint art shop, to Ryerson's Music Lab, to Daniel Spectrum Launchpad. And basically, everyone would bring their choice of gear, whether it was laptop or hardware samplers. I'm just going to scroll down to a few more pictures. And they would have 3 hours to make a track. And we'd have the same audio source, usually one vinyl. And then everyone would have to, 3 hours to make their remix version or their however they want to approach, how they want to chop the sample. We have all varying degrees of experience. Our youngest producers have been like 15 years old, oldest maybe mid 40s, very much experienced, and they all learn from each other. I think the dopest thing about Loop is that it's not a competition, and folks have different gear, hardware, software, different genres that they're into. And I think they just enjoy being in the same environment and being able to ask each other questions. And it was really dope. So yeah, the first year we met in person. And basically we were just limited by table space. And we would, try to tell people not to bring too much gear because then that's less people who could participate. But now that we're online, we can allow a few more folks, which is fun. And also, we open it up internationally too. So, some people who aren't from Toronto or from Canada can participate. And we've had some people from Europe and from Africa. I feel bad for them because of the time difference, but they seem to enjoy it and like participating. So. I'm going to just show you a recap of a short video from our 2 year anniversary that basically highlights our curator. So we select a curator for each edition, and they select the vinyl for the people to sample from. And the curator is usually someone who we all respect in the Toronto community, Canadian community, and we've had a chance to interview some really great people. So let me just show you a video of our past participants. Well, our past curators.
Wagwan.
What up? This is Shad.
What's up? I'm RC.
My name is K Wonder.
I go by the name of DJ Sirius.
Representing Cratery.
What's up? This is Eternia and Parrish.
Hi, I am Malia, also known as Mamalia.
What's up, everybody? It's your man Solitaire.
Boy Richie. Actually, I'm not your boy. You don't need me.
My name is Tanika Charles.
What's up, everyone? This is Gil Masuda.
Hey, this is Anupa Mystery, and I am the next curator.
Hey, I'm Roshini.
This is DJ Grouch.
Hello.
Hi, my name is Maylee Todd.
What's up, y'all? My name is Scratch Bassett.
I'm Slowbit Sound.
Hey, Toronto. It's Alana Stewart.
My name is Jay Douglas.
Hey, this is Carita Nassif.
Peace, y'all. It's Mathematic, represent Toronto.
DJ Merciless.
Hi, I'm Ace Misto.
Hey, everybody. I'm Fresh Kill.
My name is Toolman, and you're looking at the next guest curator for Loop Sessions Toronto. Let's get it, man.
Loop Sessions.
So, those are all DJs, producers, journalists, Hopefully some folks you recognize in there, Shad, Rich Kid, Solitaire, just folks that we really respect and want to make sure that we also highlight. You know, we do interviews with them before the event, and we actually have hours and hours of footage, which I don't know, maybe one day we'll be able to do something else with it. But we really wanted to show, you know, a nice diverse group, and genres too, you know, not just hip hop, the whole electronic spectrum we cover as well, because it's all pretty much related when it comes to electronic music or digital music. Raise your hands or comments if you recognize some of the people in the videos. Anyone? No? Everyone was new? No one knows anyone in those videos? Not Shad? Rich Kid? Wow. See, this is why you have to come check us out or follow us, because that's kind of what we're hoping, is that we can introduce these people. And they're like, a lot of them are just like OGs, you know what I mean? And just really represent the history of Toronto's music scene in a lot of ways. So it's been a lot of fun. Question, I'm curious, the idea of having 3 hours to make a track, does that sound intimidating? Or who would be open to doing something like that? I'd be curious. Anyone? No? Yes?
100%.
Yes? Marcus, you'd be down?
Oh yeah, for sure.
And you said you played the drums, yeah?
Yeah, I played the drum set for 10 years.
And do you have a DAW? Do you produce as well?
Yeah, I do. I have FL, well, I primarily use FL Studio. I also have been using Ableton Live 10 Lite, just to mm-hmm. kind of play around with some ideas. And then apart from that, I've been trying out Soundtrap as well, mm-hmm. which is also pretty unique and pretty fun to do. Mainly it's like, if I ever kind of do any project where I kind of use any of those DAWs collectively, I tend to kind of make something, say on Ableton Live 10 Lite, and then I'll take that and then export it into an MP3 or WAV file, and then push that into my FL Studio, and then just add extra stuff, and then kind of just go nuts with it. So I think each DAW has its own unique kind of thing that it brings to the table. So,
for sure, for sure. Where are you getting your sounds from? I'm curious. Are you using plugins, or are you going to any of the websites to grab sounds? Where are you getting your sounds from?
Oh man, okay, actually this is a big question. So it's really cool, because when you're mentioning saying that some people, there's an art to getting some samples from vinyls, because I'm a big believer in that too. So my sources are quite abundant. I've been getting some of the sounds from online, from free packs, or I'll join little groups and stuff like that, that kind of create their own little drum sounds or drum tracks or loop tracks or anything that I can just kind of get my hands on, I take it. And then I also have been, I have a friend who has a turntable, because I recently bought a turntable, but it doesn't have a USB to like whatever connection, so I can't record vinyls on there. But I found out a bud of mine actually has that, so I've been going over to their place, and I've been taking some of the records that I've had, because my grandparents love collecting records, and my mom has a bunch of records, so I've been kind of like robbing those in there. And then, yeah, I'm telling you, man, I got greedy with these sounds, bro. Then I started kind of meeting up with my bud, and then I would put those on the turntable, start pretty much press play and start recording the vinyl through that, and then have it go right into my FL Studio. And then that's how I get some of my other sounds. Apart from that, I'll even do little things like either record on my phone from outside. Being a drummer, I kind of follow this idea of saying like every surface is a percussive surface. So every time if I'm like chilling by like any like form of water or any type of wall, and I think it's an interesting sound or interesting echo, I usually try to record it and grab that up. So then it's just there. So like my sound bank is just ridiculous at the moment. Yeah,
that's spot on. That's yeah, you covered a lot of things there. I also agree that like all sound is fair game. Like anything, whether that's a recorded medium or whether that's you recording the atmosphere around you. And that's just the sound that you're starting from. What you do with that is endless. From filters to effects, there's so many ways that you can use a sound source to be creative. So I think that's a good segue to go into the sampling section. Okay, so like I said, if we're talking about sound sources, you either have recorded material, whether it's vinyl, CD, MP3, ripping something from the internet, YouTube, found sound, which is, you know, taking a handheld recorder and recording anything around you, DVDs, VHS, anything where you can get some sort of sound can be used as a sample. What you can also do, which has become a lot more popular as of late, is go to, there are a few websites like Splice, where you can get sounds, sample packs. There's also Tracklib. There's also Kingsway, which is run by Frank Dukes, who is from Toronto originally. And basically, you know, those things you pay, I think it's like a monthly fee for a certain amount of sounds that are pretty much license free. Or, you know, or it has a license and you pay for it. Or let's say with Kingsway and a number of other libraries, they may base the price on what you intend to do with that sample. Whether it's for a small release or whether it's for a larger commercial release, you're going to pay more money. You're going to get more percentage of that. And that's something really important to think about. Now, when I sample, I'm thinking about, am I just doing this for creativity? Or am I doing this to possibly license this track? If I'm trying to license that track, I know that there's a lot of paperwork and legal ramifications for any sort of major release. If it's just for fun, I really don't care. I'll still share it. I'm not, you know, that huge of an artist that it would make a difference. But if it were ever to get picked up for anything, I need to keep that in mind. There are going to be some legal things to deal with, you know. And I mentioned somebody like Madlib. Madlib samples like crazy. And I think I read an article that the album he did with Freddie, the most recent one, had, you know, maybe over 100 to 200 samples that they had to clear. And the thing about Madlib is not like he keeps track of this stuff. So I really feel bad for his legal team that they had to go and find all of this stuff. But I think it took them a year to get through all of it before they could even release that album. So, you know, like I said, sampling is great because it's source material. And if you're not a trained musician, it still gives you access. But it can also be extremely tricky and give you a lot of legal nightmares if it's a big project. But at the same time, you know, if somebody really wants that track, you know, if there's an artist that really wants to get on there and they have the connections to cover it, they'll make sure it happens. So I don't know. I wouldn't limit yourself if that's something that you're thinking about, but it's something to keep in mind, to say the least. So I am going to show a few different examples, a few different approaches of how you can approach a sample. And TrackLib did a really great a visual example of this. So I'm going to use a couple of their examples because they just show it highlighted so well. So there are three main ways you can approach a sample. Either you can take very small chops, like I'll call them like one shots. That can be a kick, snare, trumpet sound. They're pretty much like one note, right? So you have people who just take those small samples and kind of make their own drum kit and go from there. A lot of the old producers like Pete Rock, they had an SP-1200, which is a drum machine sampler that only had like 10 seconds of sampling time. That's nothing. 10 seconds. And yet he would make complete tracks with this. And this is why I say sometimes it's good to have limitations and try to push as much as you can with what you have before you go and get other gear. You'd be amazed at what you can do, okay? Another approach is to just take a one bar loop, which is pretty much four counts if you're doing traditional 4/4 time, you know? So it's like 1, 2, 3, 4. Just make a loop. Whether it's recognizable or whether it's obscure, you know, that's the challenge that you take on, whether you're sampling because you want it to be obvious or whether you're sampling because you want to show how dope you are with your chops and how crazy you can flip it. And then there's the really, really, really obvious sample where straight up you know what track it is that they're using. And there's a sense of familiarity. And that's what makes it cool. Because not only are you hip to it, but maybe your auntie or someone from an older generation is familiar with it too. So that gives more tracks to the, more legs to the track. So I'm going to start with a few examples. I'm gonna start with this Timbaland track for Aaliyah. Let me just get it back to the beginning. Okay. Did you sleep on the wrong side? I'm catching a bad vibe. And it's contagious. What's the latest? Speak your heart. Don't bite your tongue. All right, I'm going to play one from Daft Punk. Is everyone familiar with Daft Punk? They just retired after 20 years. And honestly, like if you hear what the samples are for certain songs, I don't know. Sometimes I feel like, wow, that's such a cheat code because it's so obvious. But, you know, it's all about what you do with the sample. And sometimes it's about introducing more people to the track. So check this out. We'll be right back.
through your life. We're just people being people, trying to survive. There's just one thing that's worth.
So the thing I really appreciate about that, like you saw, it was five different tracks, and there were so many small snippets that they took of each track, and it may not have seemed like they initially would go together, but once you you know, break all of those down, and then you have options of changing the pitch, tone, speed, adding filters. There's still so many things you can do to each one of those segments, but the way I see sampling, it's really about layering. It's a bit of a collage, and it's about arrangement. And you can literally take the same segments, everyone can have the same segments, and layer them differently, arrange them differently. You know, it's like a big collage. You know, so that's really cool how they approached it, and we're going to see this also a lot with Dilla, with JD. Here's an example. And let's check out some Mad Villain, which is MF Doom. And Madlib, here we go.
Step up front, you dig. Get down with the bus stop.
Thank you. Love the calm flow. Don't talk about my mom, yo. Sometimes he rhyme quick, sometimes he rhyme slow, or vice versa. Whip up a slice of nice verse pie, hit it on the
first. I'm gonna drop another MF Doom. Let's do one more. You know what? Let's do this K Trinata joint.
Without each other, we would not be.
So yeah, those are all different approaches to a sample, which, you know, either using really minute chops, or whether you're using small loops, or whether you're using really long loops, where it's very, very clear and evident, like what song has been sampled. Like that Sade track was very clear that MF Doom was rhyming over a Sade track. But some other things you may not catch, and whether it's intentional or not, you know, all of them are different ways that you can approach sampled music. Any questions? Has anyone ever seen it broken down like that before?
No, I was curious, like, how are you able to do that in TrackLib? Are you using TrackLib, or what are you using?
Well, it's TrackLib made that, but honestly, it looks like Serato sample.
Oh, okay.
That's what it looks like to me. Software Serato sample, that's what their waveform editor looks like. TrackLib is just a website for buying sounds or buying songs that you can then chop and use however you want. And actually, TrackLib has been partnering with some known producers, and this is happening more, where they're licensing their catalogs directly to those companies. So, you know, you want to get that James Brown sample? Well, you don't have to figure out who owns it, who's the publisher, what's the label, who do I need to go through? It's like, okay, you can go directly to the source. They tell you straight up how much it's going to cost you. You pay for the license, and that's it. You know, so this is a lot of what's been happening the last some odd years. It definitely wasn't this easy before to get your hands on like a known sample by a known artist. So yeah, that's pretty interesting. Me myself, I haven't used Splice or TrackLib. I prefer to find my own samples from different places. One, because it's fun for me. It's just more fun searching for cool stuff. I don't like things spoon-fed to me. That's just not fun. And two, if I find my own sounds, it's less of a chance that other people are going to have it. And if they do, it's still going to be rare. You know, it's not going to be like, oh, I got that James Brown sample pack that everyone's using. That's not fun for me. There are a couple of drum packs that I'll play around with, but for me personally, I'm kind of a movie digger, and I like to record different sounds from movies. That's my thing. But also because I feel like, you know, there are only, 12 notes? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. There are only 12 notes in an octave. And even if it's a different instrument, there's still only so much stuff you can do with those 12 notes. So I like to include a lot of other sounds and textures and layer them into my percussion and to melodies and stuff like that. I think that's just a lot more fun. And like I said, like having been making beats for 25 years, like that's what's important to me is making it fun for me. It's not about imitating or trying to duplicate. I'm trying to be different in a way, maybe not different intentionally, but just doing what I think would be an interesting approach for sampling.